the great things in this household today, Father God. We just want to say we adore you. We worship you, God. Lord, we're looking forward to what it is you're going to do in this place on today. We say have your way in this place, oh God. Transform the people who come on today, Father God. And let no one leave this place the same way they came, God. Lord, I thank you for an atmosphere and a spirit of expectation, Father God. Thank you, God. You are worthy, O 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 God. And we say thank you, God. We don't take anything for granted, Father God. Even the activity of our limbs, Father God. The fact that we woke up this morning in our right mind, Father God, we say thank you. And we don't take anything for granted. Lord, we bless the people as they're on their way, Father God. Give them traveling mercies, Father God. We come against incidents and accidents as the people are on their way, Father God. And I just pray that as the people walk through this door, they will feel the tangible presence of the Holy Spirit in this place, oh God. Lord, we thank you. Have your way, oh God.
Hallelujah. We thank you for peace that'll be in the place today. today. We thank you for your glory that will be in this place today. We thank you for your power that will be manifested in this place today. We thank you, God, for the spirit of truth that will be in this place today. Father, we thank you for the revelation that will flow in the house today. Father, we thank you for your word will run forth swiftly. We thank you, God, for the angels that will come and worship with us today. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, that you will display your glory in this house.
We honor. We magnify the name of Jesus. We glorify the name of Jesus. We exalt the name of Jesus. We bless the name of Jesus. Oh, because when we call on your name, demons flee. When we call on your name, everything bows down. Yes, God, we just call on Jesus. We worship you in this place today. We worship you in this house today. We worship you in this house today. We worship you in this place. Oh my God, God, you got the most shot.
Shaka de boko samareke de boko. Sotombi
Excited about what Holy Spirit has given us for today. Lord Jesus, hallelujah! Excited, hallelujah! So glad to see you, glory to God, hallelujah! Y'all go hug her, go hug her. George is in the house, glory to God.
Good to me. He's been good to me.
Thank you. closer to him by abundance, by reading his word, by coming to the household of faith. Pastor Donna, Pastor Billy, the church family members, the people, by being connected with his anointed ones and his anointed. It's such amazing. God changed things. We just got to stay connected with the word. We got to be with the word. That's the only way we're going to live and make it. Peace in our life, knowledge and understanding and covering and love and knowing what love is about. It makes a difference. It makes a change.
It makes a difference.
And he's good. God, he has changed me. And I love it. And I love the Lord.
What did Jesus used to be like?
He turned it around.
You are good to me, and I
life.
It's been a trial. Yeah, it's been a lot of challenges. Yeah. God has seen me through each and every one of them. And more importantly, the promises that I have, expectancy that He's going to continue to bring me through, bring me out, heal my body.
Amen.
Change my story, transform me, because He is just that kind of God.
Thank
a
you.
Loving, wonderful, kind, mighty, terrible
amen.
God.
Amen.
Love you, Father. I thank you that you never give up on us.
Amen.
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 knowing Jesus changed your life.
Yes.
I grew up knowing about Jesus, and I went to church, and I knew the scriptures, but I didn't know him as my Savior, as my Jesus. And then I was in school and college, and I began to look back over my life, and I saw all of the places where he kept me, all of the dumb things that I'd done, all of the stupid choices that I made, and he kept me. And I realized that even when I was running from him, he was running to me. When I was turning my back on him, he was coming to me and putting his arms around me. And when I realized this is Jesus, my Jesus, not my mom's Jesus, not my grandma's Jesus, my Jesus, my friend. And when I was sad and I was depressed and I didn't love myself, he whispered in my ear, daughter, I love you. More than anybody on the face of this earth can ever love you. And I created you for a purpose. And I filled your heart with compassion and joy. Now you go spread that to the people that you come in contact with. Because you may be the only Jesus that some of these people see. And that's how he changed me. He helped me to see the beauty in every situation. The beauty in every person. The beauty in everything. Because everything that the enemy means for evil, God uses that thing, and he changes us, and he gives the glory, and all that we go through, and all that we do is about him. And it's not about us. It's not about nothing us. Is about us. It's all about the God that we serve being glorified in our lives, and that we live in such a way that our lives glorify him. I learned that it wasn't about what you do in the church. It's about that lifestyle that you live all the time. Where people can see Jesus in everything. And that's how he changed me. That my life is worship. Who I am is worship. That's how he changed me.
Thank you.
He is so good. And I sing because he is good. I cry because he is good. I rejoice because he is good.
To be a light in a dark place to my friends. It's allowed me to be a dark, I mean a light at work. It's allowed me to walk in love. Walk in love with my wife. It's allowed me to walk in love with my co-workers. It's allowed me to transform my mind. It's allowed me to renew my mind. So knowing Jesus has tremendously changed my life. I mean, I was addicted to marijuana. Most of y'all probably would never believe that. I was addicted to marijuana for several years. Going through all kind of mess in college, places I shouldn't have been, doing things I shouldn't have done. But God kept me in his perfect will, man. I shouldn't be me where I am right now.
Yes.
But God.
But God.
But God. His grace and His mercy kept me. His grace and His mercy kept me. And even now, my friends ask me, like, what's it like being married? It's the perfect will of God. It's the perfect will of God. Like, how did you know you're supposed to get married? Because I listened to God. I had a friend the other day ask me, what church you go to? It was at work. What church do you go to? Because there's something different about you. That's because I walk in love. When they get on my nerves, I walk in love.
Amen. All the time. All the time.
Last thing, I've been working a temp assignment for a year and a half. My temp assignment was supposed to be for 60 days. 60 days. That was last March. They gave me a temp assignment, said you'll be here for 60 days. I'm still there a year later.
So the job don't know that's your permanent spot.
That's my permanent spot. But I walk in love and I honor God in my job.
Yeah.
I honor God in everything that I'm doing, even the smallest things.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Come on.
demonstrate.
My point. I don't want to be fake.
That's right.
And stand up here and start telling y'all all this other stuff. Like about that it's not even happening right now because I really got a lot of stuff in my life.
Yeah.
Going on right now.
Yeah.
It's a lot. It's a lot going on.
Yeah.
I changed my life. I mean, I'm trying to be at peace because I'm hectic. Like my mind and stuff is hectic. And I am bipolar depressed. So that's why I don't come to church. And I don't do all that because I don't like coming in here and putting in on people that I'm in church with. But one thing that is changing about me is that I'm becoming much calmer.
Yeah.
I don't like people, and I mean anybody. But I'm starting to
love
on people and wanting to be like being around people.
Yeah.
Because I'm real antisocial. If y'all don't think so, I talk a lot. But I don't talk to people. I don't like talking to people.
Yeah, be real.
With my daughter, the devil tries to attack me with her every day.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just learning to love on her and don't get upset with her or nothing. Just Bella, if she can't hear me, just act like we can't hear each other. Then at that moment, instead of me yelling at her and stuff, I've been out of work for 7 months and been having to depend on her dad. When I tell you that's the worst situation for me in my life because I'm used to getting my own money. And I'm trying to explain to people let's let me say that. When I first started coming to Household of Faith the way that I am now, and all this other stuff, how I am, I wasn't like this. I'm from the hood. Like, I know how to go get money. It's like, I don't even want to go get money how I know how to get money.
Yeah.
And I'm not paying or nothing like that, but I know how to get money. Like, you know, I know how to do all these things, and I just don't have the need to or the feel to want to do any of those things.
Yeah.
A year ago, because I let my depression eat me, where people were standing next to me and just getting wet. That's how I want to be.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I'm becoming different, but I just can't
fake it. I'm becoming different.
I'll tell like my real testimony, because trust me, it's coming, because I've been up down like this all for years, for like 2 years. But everything is, as I'm looking at it, everything's fine. Because there's just a lot of stuff going on. I'm telling you, you're trying to get me. Y'all really not understanding how bad this man is trying to get
me. Yeah, we do.
But just because I know how to, I be wishing like, I wish I could come see
him. Mm-hmm.
I want to see him really, but I can't come in here because all I'm going to do is break down.
It's okay, break down.
But I know how to pick up my Bible. And I know how to pray.
Yeah.
She know how to pray.
Yeah.
And she pray with me with stuff.
Yeah.
I used to be turned off. They still be on for 2 more months.
Then he can rebuild. He takes the clay and he starts doing what? He's the potter, you the clay. So this is the fight to come and break now. Every time you need to break down, come here so he can rebuild. That's what he do.
Don't stay away.
Don't stay away.
Go ahead,
Donnie. I left and went to Georgia. If anybody didn't know, I was gone. So that's why I wasn't able to come into church and stuff. I needed to go to my mom. Like, I needed to get to my mom. I needed to breathe. Because it was something inside, it wasn't like it was in my house, but it was something on me, like that I felt like it was, I kept nitpicking it, like, oh, you're not going to do this, no, that's not happening. I have a whole business that I'm trying to start, and he was picking at that. I got mom, I'm going back to school, and he's picking with that, like he's trying to mess up my transcripts, like all that, and I'm praying about it. But then I was doubting, and my mom was like, stop doubting, like, stop doubting God. Stop doubting what he can do. Stop doubting it. I'm like, mom, whatever, you know, just whatever. I don't think he was talking about whatever, mom. Ended up getting locked up. So I'm just going through all this stuff. I'm trying to tell you. Ended up getting arrested and went to jail. Like, they went and made me my prissy self. I'm in the jail, like, I don't care, man, whatever. Like,
be breaking down on my knees and be praying. And right when I got done praying, the people came and got me out that cell that was too small because I'm claustrophobic. Said, let's go. You can put your clothes back on. They outside to come pick you up. When I screamed glory so hard in the inside of that jail. And this just was 2 months ago. So it's just...
trust, nobody to lean on but my wife and my family. At the time when I got locked up, my oldest daughter, she was young, wasn't even a year old.
Right.
So when I was in the jailhouse, an older man hit me about. I said, I don't trust nobody here. He said, let me tell you something, you don't have to trust me. but you can trust Jesus.
Amen.
So I began to, you know, to read the Bible, you know, when I was up there. So, you know, you have to surround yourself with some God-fearing people.
That's right.
People that love the Lord.
Amen.
They believe in God more than you believe in yourself.
Amen.
So, you know, when I was younger, when I went in prison, me and my wife used to pray. I got so frustrated. I said, they done gave me 12 years for a small crime compared. I know people got lesser time for bigger crime.
My
wife and I used to pray. My wife used to pray. She started going to church. She was telling me that she had started falling in love with Jesus more because it was embedded in her through her grandmother. Her grandmother was one of the strongest prayer warriors I ever known in my entire life. I mean, she would plead the blood of Jesus. My wife used to tell me when they was young, she would get all the grandchildren and put them on their knees. No matter what they wanted to do, they had to do what grandmama said. They had to get on their knees and pray. And my wife, when she got locked up, I'm going to tell y'all, single women, you have to have a strong man in your life.
Yeah.
You have to have a strong man. My wife, she was my helpmate. She was strong. She was more strong than me being locked up. Had more faith than me getting out by myself because I began to doubt.
Amen.
You know, when you're going through stuff, you'll get to doubt. But, you know, once you get to know that friend, the father figure in Jesus, and she learned that in Faith, Hope, and Charity. She was with the older saints, prayer warriors. They used to have communion, go in fried to come out money, no food, no water, no drink, just humbly laying out before the Lord. And you know, that's what them older saints, they did. They laid out. And my wife, she was praying, praying, praying. And it got so frustrating me, y'all. I used to tell my wife, she used to come every week, 3.5-4 hours. She done came in the blizzards up in storm. I said, baby, don't come, because when she come, I look so pitiful when she leave. But you know what? The devil thought he had me. He kept tormenting my mind, saying, you know what? You're going to pour these 12 years. My wife began to pray and pray and pray. All of a sudden, I was locked up 9 months, 23 days. I got that call from that front office. They said, Ronell Mills, come to the sergeant desk. I said, man, what they want me at the sergeant desk? That morning, I was frustrated. I was in small infant class. I didn't even want to go to the class. They said, come up to the sergeant. Then they said, Ronell Mills, come to the counseling. I said, what, I'm going to go to counseling? And the security guard said, we're going to bust you back. You got marijuana in your system. I said, sir, I don't smoke no marijuana. So I know I ain't got that in. But you know what? Sometimes things do happen. I had to learn this for myself.
All right, now.
Every good thing don't come. God don't give you everything good. Sometimes he will allow stuff because it brought me back to the scripture of Job. Even though the devil thought he can win against Job, but God told him, I want you to test my faithful man, Job. Everybody got a Job inside yourself.
All right.
You're going to be tested.
Yes.
But that day when they called me to the altar, when man said, I got the poor 12 years, but God said, it ain't so.
Amen.
So we have to have in our spirit, don't worry about what man said, because God can overturn all obstacles in your life.
Amen.
It may look dim, it may look dark, but guess what? God brings everything to the marvelous light.
Amen.
But I had a faithful wife that prayed and prayed. And you know what? That right there was a learning experience for me, but I can guarantee, I can tell y'all that I haven't been back to that way.
Amen.
All right now.
And the message that once God delivers you some, don't let the devil put a trap back in your thoughts.
Amen.
The devil set more traps than what we can impede our thoughts to. That's all he want to do. He the master of deceiving your mind.
That's right.
Whatever he allows you to believe in your mind, it'll flow to your heart.
That's right.
Don't let that happen, because you know your mind can always think. You can think things can happen to you, but you ain't got to allow it. Just like sin, you can have that in your mind. I can kill somebody, but don't let it flow out your mouth. Rebuke it right there.
Right, right, right.
A lot of things, you know, God give us power over everything we do. The devil can't beat you.
No.
He can't win. It's what you allow the devil to do. Keep that Holy Spirit in the tree. Saying from the heavens, for the devil to have authority with the Holy Spirit in you, you already done defeated. God took that to the cross. It now been delivered and sealed and signed. So when you have the Holy Spirit, like you said, young lady, use that weapon. That weapon is fasting and praying.
That's right.
Right there, my wife, She get up 5:30 in the morning. She pray for a lot of folks, everybody. Because that's what we have to do as a church.
Right.
We is the body. We is the embodiment of God. We are the church.
Right.
So we have to pray for everybody, not just a selfish prayer for
that's
yourself.
Right.
Everybody on the sound of the heavens should be blessed in their way. Everybody got a talk, you have a ministry, you have something that can help and deliver somebody. The word of God teaches us we overcome through our testimony. Don't hide nothing good what God already done delivered you through. Share it with somebody. Somebody can be going through it right now. Why you gonna hold something good that God done gave you a message? You know what I do? I give that message to young men that comes in
that's
my
right.
shop.
That's right.
I used to be afraid to tell them that. But one young man told me that one day, he said, you know what, Mills, when you gave me that message that one day, he said, I went home and I prayed. Because I told him, I said, look, when you go to a job and you got God on your side, don't say, I hope I get the job. Walk in with expectation, say, I got that job. I got that promotion. I got that healing. I got that deliverance.
That's right.
Speak with confidence.
That's right.
Speak it.
That's right.
Speak it in the atmosphere.
That's right.
Write it on the wall. My wife does it all the time. Have y'all ever seen the movie War Room?
Yeah.
You see what that lady went through. But she spoke it, she believed it, and she worked it out. I learned this. When you work with God, God gonna work with you. We got to continue to walk upright. We got to walk in faith. No matter what nobody said, they would call you crazy. If you had to walk down the sidewalk, speak to God right then, no matter what people said, they probably call me crazy, Joe, too. But sometimes you have to speak that thing to throw they work. Do not be afraid of the devil. The devil can't do nothing.
No,
our weakness in our mind, what we think we can allow the devil to do. The devil been defeated, it's in the scriptures.
It's a beast.
It tells you the Bible. Soon Jesus went to the cross when he was defeated, he came down like the quickest a ball of light shot to the ground. That's how quick. You got to stop that devil out your life.
Come on, stop.
You got to stop that devil out your life. You got to stop that devil. It's not going to happen no more. You've been defeated on the cross. You ain't going to steal my job. You ain't going to steal my children. You ain't going to steal my husband. You ain't going to steal my wife.
That's right.
I'm telling you, Lucifer. You're defeated.
Hey,
speak to
him. Now stand up. Come on.
Speak to him.
Tell him. No, you're not.
Tell him. No, you're not.
You're not going to have my money.
You're not going to have
my children. You're not going to have my money.
Use your power.
You're not going to have
it. Use your power.
When you operate in faith, the way you show you have faith, if someone gives you an instruction, you do it right away. That's how you step in out on faith. When you pull back and do what you choose to do, you miss it. If she say, get out your seat, walk and step on the devil, hey, that's what you do instantly. You move, because that's how Holy Spirit is speaking to you. Do it.
Come on. Come on, put your mouth.
said surrender. When you said the surrender, Holy Ghost said we need to look at it the way we surrender to things of the world.
Yes,
surrender
yes.
to Him the same way.
Amen.
See, things of the world, we surrender to them when we know they're wrong.
That's right.
This
right.
is totally right.
Yeah.
So you need to be surrendering yourself like you lost your mind. But when we saw the world, we did anything because it's better.
That's right. That's right.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Thank you. I surrender to Him.
John chapter 8. Ooh, glory. Oh my God, this is going to get real good. Y'all ready?
Yes.
John chapter 8. Yes, we are. Oh yeah, you got it. Hold up. This is Jesus church. It's not our church. It's Jesus church. Whatever he's on. You got it.
I wasn't going to say anything, but since everybody gave a testimony, God said you better not sit down on the
table
what I've gone through. But I was in college and I was in my sophomore year going into my junior year, and I just kept getting headaches, and I had a strong GPA over 3.0, and as you know, anybody who's been to college, biology is a hard degree. We had physics, calculus, and everything like that, and I remember coming home telling my mom, like, I feel dumb, like, I can't remember things, and I just don't know what's going on. So after that happened, I started having these episodes of, I would just black out. I was at work, I blacked out. I was at the apartment by myself, I blacked out. I was at the mall, and I just fell, and it started getting worse. So this has been going on since 2 years. So my senior year last year, I remember I passed out while I was picking up some medicine, and when I woke up, the nurse said you didn't have a pulse. So I thank God, and I went to the hospital, and they've been doing tests on me. Every time I passed out, they would think it would be my heart, but they never did one on my brain. And so come to find out, for the past couple of years, I had brain tumors. And so that was causing me to pass out. And I went to Duke, and Duke scheduled an appointment for me to have surgery to get the tumors taken out. And I was scared. I mean, this is not a regular surgery. I'm not getting a hip replacement or something like that. This is my brain that you're going to be working on. And so I canceled the surgery, and I was just like, I'm not going to do it. You know, I just can't do it. And so I built up the confidence to go ahead and schedule another appointment, and I ended up having the surgery in August. But up to that time, you can't imagine what I was going through. I was so scared for somebody to be, I mean, just the worst things, the devil saying, you're not going to wake up, or I've known people that had the surgery who, after they had the surgery, are crazy. You know, they can't think for themselves, and I'm just blessed to be able to have went through that surgery, and my mind is stronger than it was before.
Thank you.
So I told God, so wherever I go, I'm going to tell this testimony, because that's just, I'm just glad to be living. A lot of you glad to have money, to have food. I'm just glad to be living.
Amen.
So I just have to thank God for that.
Amen. Thank you for that.
God bless
them all. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
All I can tell y'all is church is about to change up in here.
Yes.
No. Church is about to change up in here.
Yes.
Even y'all notice ain't no center aisle no more. I was talking to my husband, and I was talking to Cassandra yesterday, and I said, you know what? Something Holy Spirit's dealing with me about something. It's like we get in here, and then there's that section people, and then there's that section
people. All right.
And then there's that family over here, and this family sits over here, and this family sits over here. And I said, and all these children in here, they don't even know each other.
if they saw them in Walmart, they go, oh, she go to our church. Don't even know her name. Mm-hmm. Right. I said, that's about to stop up in here.
Right, yeah.
That's about to stop. I said, we a family, and we're going to be a family. And I said, what I want some of y'all to do is when you come in, don't sit where you normally sit. Sit by your assignment.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Who's your assignment in the room? Amen.
Come in and say, Holy Ghost, who's my assignment?
Who's my assignment in the room? Who needs to be next to my praise today?
Yeah.
Who needs to see my smile today?
Oh.
Who needs my hug today?
Yes.
I need y'all to start knowing. Do you know her name? This Nivea. Tell her, Nivea, look. Find out her name. Would y'all find out somebody's name? Please find out somebody's name. Find out somebody's name. Morgan, you know kind of name. Find out somebody's name, please.
Yes.
Church got to change up in here. We are one family.
One family.
We are one family. Hey, this is the Jesus Christ Free Family
Amen.
Reunion.
That's right.
What y'all at? The Jesus Christ Family Reunion. That's what y'all at. I didn't know you belonged to Jesus. Y'all do. I'm going to the family reunion. See, don't tell people I'm going to church on Sunday. I'm going to the family reunion.
Hey, but can I tell something real quick?
Yeah, yeah.
When we was in Texas at the convention, Kenneth Copeland, my wife and I came downstairs in the lobby getting ready to go to the meeting. He came to my wife. He said, you know what?
Who's he?
Kenneth Copeland came to my wife and said, you know what? I know you're part of the family. I can look. In tell.
Yes, he did.
That's right.
He said, you part of the family. You finna go to the convention. I can look and tell you are one of us.
Go.
That's right.
That's what Kenneth Copeland did. Just like, hey, you are one of the family. I know where you're going.
Hey, why don't y'all look at somebody and say, you one of us.
You one of us.
You one of us.
You one of us.
You one of us. When you go to family reunion, don't they do that? They say, girl, you look just like our baby. You look just like our baby. Ooh, you got Uncle Bubba's nose.
Uncle Bubba, right here.
Come on, wouldn't that be special? They say, ooh, you look just like Jesus.
Amen.
You look just like Jesus. You got to be in the family. Come on, I got to be in the family. Okay, all right, go ahead, baby. John chapter 8, 1 through 12, we're going to read it quickly.
Right.
We preached it last week.
But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Now early in the morning, he came again into the temple. And all the people came to him, and he sat down and talked. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act.
Wait, now, but she was caught in the very act. Y'all got it? All right, let's go.
Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say? This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his fingers, as though he did not hear. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and said to them, He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went on one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last, and Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you? She said, No one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, Neither do I condemn you, I'm sorry, go and sin no more.
Okay, so we had a great time with this story last week. We had fun making Leslie, the woman caught in adultery, and she volunteered to be Jesus. Isn't she smart? She volunteered. Tammy volunteered to be Jesus. And so a lot of you weren't here last week, so we want to make sure that you are up to where we are, right? And so one of the things we asked everybody is Jesus said to her, go and sin no more. And I asked the question of how did he expect her to do that? What did he give her? What did he give her so that she could go do what he called her to do? He said, I don't condemn you, right? So we said this right here. We said love, because we're on the power of love. That's what we're teaching. And we said love will not only forgive you, love will set you free.
Mm-hmm.
Watch this. Because we said, he said, now neither do I condemn you. But then he turns to her and says, go and sin no more. And so those of you who were here, what did he give her? What did he give her so that she could accomplish it? What did he give her?
Cut
her. He gave her the word. Watch this. Y'all said, what word did he give her? He said, if he said, anything he said is the word.
Is the word.
So he said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Well, what? You're like, what in the world? Now, how's she supposed to do that off of just that right there? Now, look, Leslie made me have to go write another one, because last week she took it home. So we said,
go and sin no more.
And sin no more. Now, last week we said a woman caught in adultery. Now, how's supposed to go and sin no more? The word, you need to hear this. Just one word from God Amen. Is powerful enough to keep you.
Amen.
Oh, wait, let's say that. One word from God is powerful enough to keep me.
That's right.
Come on, make it personal. One word from God is powerful enough to keep me. Now watch it. She got five. Go and sin no more.
Amen.
Now, we said, now, you know that spirit of adultery, she used to that. It's going to come back and visit her.
Oh, yes.
And when it come back to visit her, what does she have that she can use against it? What you got? Go and sin
no more.
She got to rehearse what Jesus said to her. Come on here.
Yes.
Now, we said there's the spoken word, and so there's some times that God has spoken some things to you.
Amen.
You got to know how to hold that
That's
word.
That's right.
And then, if there's not a prophetic word, there's the written word.
Yes, mm-hmm.
All you got to do is hold on to that word right there and go. What do you go with? You go with the word.
Amen.
Okay, so then we went to Joshua 1 and 8, and we said this. You going to do that one? Joshua 1 and 8. Glory to God, and then we're going to jump over and we're ready to go. Ooh, this is going to be good. It's going to be good. Glory to Jesus. Joshua 1 and 8. Hallelujah. Ooh. What do I take with me?
Yes.
The battle against those thoughts and those things that try to hold me captive, yes. Glenn Getter, you take the word.
You take the word. Put the word on it.
Oh, that's where we were last time, right?
Word yes.
Glory to God. Matter of fact, let me help y'all. Last week, we talked about, y'all remember, Jenny, you remember when they used to have that commercial, Shout It Out?
Yeah.
You put that on the spot,
yeah.
And what you do with the spot? It's a spot remover. So we decided at Household of Faith, we don't shout it out, we word it out. Come on, let's call it that. Word it out. How do you get rid of the thing that's trying to grab hold of you?
Word
it out. Glory be to God. We put the word on it.
Put the word.
All right, Joshua 1 and 8. Y'all there? Let's read it together. Let's go.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success.
Did y'all notice those thens?
Yeah.
What that mean? It means I got to do the stuff before in order to get the stuff after the then. I got to do the stuff before the then in order to get the stuff after the then. Let's do it again. I got to do the stuff before the then to get the stuff after the then. So what I got to do? Meditate in what?
On the word.
On the word. How often?
Day and night.
Day and night.
And observe to what?
Do it according.
Observe to do it.
According, like to what the word said.
So this is what we had fun saying last week. You got to see it. Say it, do it. Come on. You got to see it, say it, do it. Let's do it again. You got to see it, say it, do it. Come on again. You got to see it, say it, do it. Okay, what's it?
The word.
Word.
All right, let's say that. You got to say the word, see the word, do the word. Hey.
You got to
say the word, see the word, do the word. Hey.
You got to
say the word, see the word, do the word. Hey. You got to say the word, see the word, do the word. Hey. I love it. Hey. Come on. Wasn't that good?
You're good. Very good.
What you got to do? Got to say the word, see the word, do the word.
Say the word,
see the word,
do the word.
And do the word. There we go. And then.
And then.
Okay. Leslie, I think you're good. But sit in the front, though, because we're going to meet y'all. All right. Go to Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Ooh, glory to God. So Jesus tells her, go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Now how he expects me to do that? Go and sin no more. He expects me to rehearse the word.
That's right.
He expects me to grab hold to the word that he gave me. Hey, let's say this. The word is my weapon.
The word is my weapon.
Ooh, glory to God. Isn't that good? The word is my my weapon. Yeah, and the word is what I use. Wait, see, y'all didn't know that. The word is what I use. Amen. It's not for it to just stay in them pages of the book. The word is what I use. I'm supposed to use the word. I'm supposed to say, I'm supposed to see it, say it, and do it. What you supposed to do? See it, say it, and do it. Say it again. See it. Say it.
There's no need of having a weapon if you know how to use it.
All right.
You must be equipped, and you have to do what you practice with the weapon for accuracy.
Okay, so y'all at Psalm 119?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to start at verse 9. We're reading 9 through 11. Come on, y'all read it too. Ready? Let's go.
How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word.
Let's stop right there. How can a young man cleanse his way? How this woman caught in adultery gonna cleanse her way? How can I, let's make it personal, how can I cleanse my way? What does that mean, cleanse my way?
I guess stop doing it.
Clean it up.
Stop
sinning. How can I do that? What is that next? The next line. By what? Wait a minute, by let you know how.
By living according to the word.
By taking heed. What does taking heed mean? What does it mean? Come on.
Acknowledging it.
Wait. Let me tell you what taking heed means. See it, say it, do it. What does taking heed mean? See it, say it, do it.
Amen.
So he said, how does a man cleanse his way? By doing what? Taking heed to what?
The word.
To the word. So if I take heed, if I see it, say it and do it, it'll clean my life up.
Amen.
Wait a minute, come on. If I see it, say it, and do it, it'll clean my life up. Did y'all see that? It'll cleanse my way. Okay, what's the next verse? Let's read verse 10 together. Let's go.
With my whole heart I have sought thee. Oh, let me not wander from your command.
Wait, what's the command?
The word.
The word. So with my whole heart, I'm seeking God.
Yes.
I don't want to wander away from the word.
Amen.
Now watch this. Why does the enemy want you to wander away from the word?
He knows your weapon.
Because he knows it's your weapon.
Amen.
That's
right.
Anytime, watch this. Anytime somebody come with a gun, what you try to do? You want to get the gun away from the person.
All right. Amen.
Because it's the weapon.
I'm going to run.
You going to run too?
Yeah, I'm going to run.
Okay, so now watch this. Go ahead, Dad.
But with the weapon now, listen, with the weapon, you have to be equipped to use the weapon. So if the word is the weapon, you must be equipped to use it. Because you can have a weapon and not qualify to use it, you just have a weapon. So it's qualifications. You have a weapon.
Yeah.
But if you don't make the qualifications to use it, it's just a weapon.
What's the qualification?
Qualification is to know the word, identify it, say it.
See it, say it, do it. Wait a minute. So I don't wait till I'm in warfare to pull out my weapon.
It's good.
Wait, Jay, oh, should I tell that, Jay? Jay goes to the gun range. What you go there for? To practice what? Hitting that target, so that if you ever have to, wait a minute, because that way you already know how.
Right.
Practice makes permanent.
You want to see it?
Not perfect. Practice makes permanent.
You want to see it on a larger scale? Larger scale. Your military, United States military, do it every day. We don't have a war every day, but we are preparing for it, so when it is a war, we don't got to go back and try to figure out what to do. We already have things in place to where we can operate right now.
Right now.
So you practice in that scenario that if it's a live situation. And they get tired of it. It could be 8 hours a day, 12 hours a day, but if that's your job, you're going to know you can sleep and know exactly what to do with your weapon.
So don't wait till trouble comes to see it, say it, and do it.
Right, right.
You see it, say it, and do it. You see it, say it, and do it. You see it, say it, and do it. Every day.
Amen.
The enemy know once he attacked you, if you're trying to get your war plan together, you already lost.
Amen.
Because he done already attacked you. So guess what? The first one throw the first weapon or the first bullet probably going to win. So you have to beat him at his punch. when he know you're not prepared and he get the first point, he already got you. You going now trying to get a war plan, he already fighting.
I'm going to tell y'all this. See, at Household of Faith, we come packing.
We come packing.
What I'm talking about, we teach you the word.
Listen.
You got bullets in your weapon.
Uzi.
Come on here.
Uzi. Uzi.
Ain't nobody got time for that. Hey.
Yeah.
No, you better know what this word says right here. You need some bullets. Tell somebody you need some bullets.
You need some bullets.
Now, listen to me. Come now, come now. We do the Uzi effect here. Not pat pat. That's how we do it. We don't come pat pat. We don't got time for that. Uzi is a war. You could take out quite a bit one shot. Just lay your hand on the trigger. That's how I do. When you take your hand off, it stops shooting. Not pat. Pat, we don't got time for that. When we take out the enemy, we're gonna go done.
Take him out.
That pat, give him a chance to get away. Cut him down. Pat, he can duck. No, duck that.
Yeah,
that's how the word should come.
Because you see it say it and do it so much. What? It becomes permanent. That practice made it permanent. You ain't even got time to call your prayer partner. You don't need a prayer partner. Come on. Holy Ghost is your prayer partner.
I see the enemy when you come to y'all and you start shooting with that Uzi. I see the enemy ducking, running, telling the posse, go, go. Don't go that way.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's what I'm talking about.
If you start seeing it, say it and doing it so much, they'll skip your house. Wait, come on here. They'll skip your house. He said, oh no, they got weapons over there, and they use them.
They use them.
They crazy over there. That girl will pull it out and shoot.
Listen, he's trying to increase his army, not decrease it. So if you're going to kill him, he ain't coming to you. He's trying to increase. I can probably get you on my team. When he know you're finna decease it, he's not coming to you.
Okay, so Jay got something about see it, say it, do it, practice makes permanent. What you say, Jay?
The reason I go to the gun range so much is for muscle memory.
That's right.
After you do something so many times, your muscles automatically remember what to do, even if you're not in an action. So. Yeah, my wife will tell you that I walk around the house and I'm looking crazy because I'm practicing my draw just in case I ever get in a situation. I know how to get my gun out, even without thinking about it, thinking twice. So, I mean.
I got to tell y'all something. One time, I asked Jay to come and pray for the people. And so, I had no idea that he was packing. And so, I get ready to go to the podium to preach, and I go to pull out my Bible, and I put my hand on his gun. I didn't even know it was in there. I was like, oh my God. But watch this. You need to be equipped at all times.
All times.
Hear that in the spirit. You need to be equipped at all times. Because what is the enemy waiting for till you don't have it?
That's right.
He's waiting for you not to have it. He's waiting for you to miss church Sundays in
a row.
He's waiting for that.
That's right.
He's looking for the opportune time.
He's the one that's talking to you, so you will miss it. He said, if I get it on the third one, I'm good. He the one talking to you, so you go, don't go, you're tired today.
No, watch this.
But they're going to preach the same old
thing. They having a meeting, the demons. They said, we got her. She missed church one week.
Yeah, easy.
Yeah, let's watch next week. Let's get next week. Let's make her feel bad.
Right.
She don't want to, I can't go in there.
Yeah.
I can't even show up.
I did something wrong.
I can't go. I can't go, Dina.
Yeah.
That I can't go.
They
don't
know. When they see you, they can look at David and tell what you did.
I can't go. What's he trying to get you to do? See, you rehearsing it.
You rehearsing it.
Watch this.
Yes, I can.
It doesn't matter what words you rehearse.
Right.
Whatever words you rehearse is what you'll do. Wait, come on. Whatever word I rehearse is what I'll do.
So you could take something this small and the way you rehearsing it look like a mountain. This small, you done said it so much it looked like the most powerful thing in your life because you did what you magnified it every time it's talking to you. You entertain it. So it get bigger. It get bigger. And one word will it will just disintegrate.
Let's do verse 11. Y'all ready? Ready? Let's go. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Wait a minute. What are you hiding in your heart?
The word.
Why are you hiding it there?
So that I don't sin against you.
That would say to me the word is powerful enough to keep me out of sin.
Right.
The word have I hid it. See, not your pastor.
All right.
Who's got to do the hiding?
I do.
I got to do the hiding. The word, have I done what? Hidden. Where at?
In my heart.
In my heart. We're going to, but we'll do the mark for next time.
Real quick. The enemy will, listen, sometimes things we do, we don't even know it's a sin. Because the enemy and I got us so comfortable with it that it's okay. The worst sin we have, do you know, and I'm going to just share, is worrying. How many people have worried in their lifetime and maybe do it now? Do you know that is the biggest sin? Because it sounds so quiet. Oh, it's just so quiet. It's okay to worry. I got the electric bill tomorrow. Well, do you have the money? If I worry about it, cast it. Cast it. If you don't have it today, you ain't gonna have it tomorrow. So when you say, Lord, I know tomorrow you'll have it there and going about your business, you just a worry.
Right. In
a word, that blood pressure don't win. That's what the enemy is trying to kill you.
Now let me tell you how to do that. See, if you've been seeing, saying, and doing, all of a sudden you start meditating on that.
Yeah.
Right? I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord.
Yeah.
I will trust. See, wait. That's what you gotta do. When that spirit's trying to talk to you.
Amen.
What you gotta do? You start saying some stuff. You start rehearsing some stuff. You start singing some stuff. You got like this. You make yourself.
Make yourself.
Wait a minute. Hold up. Wait a minute. Where my weapon?
Where my weapon?
The moment you do that, they're out of there.
They out of there.
They ain't staying around for no fight with you.
No, they're not.
Come on, we gotta learn how to make the devil run.
Run.
Yeah.
Okay, so now, the word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against God. Glory be to Jesus. All right, who likes football?
Yeah.
Because I'm the man who got to help. Okay, if you like football, come on up here.
How many you need?
You might need to keep out of your shoes, though. Come on. I need a team over here, You might need to give up the baby. Come on, Gladiator. Do you need to take your shoes off?
No, ma'am.
Okay, come on over here. Come on. Oh, some of y'all raise your hand now. I said, come up here. Y'all won't come. That's okay. Come on.
We need some team.
Okay, I need a team on this side.
I promise you ain't gonna beat each other.
I need a team on this side. Okay, now watch.
Now, sugar, let them know it's normally 11 on the team, but we'll do it with three.
We'll do it with three. Okay. Now, Jay, you're a football player. Come, you're a football watcher.
I don't know if you're a football player.
You're a football watcher. Who else watch? Come on. Pull them shoes out. I knew you should hear that. Pull that pitch off your paint. Okay, you good. Okay, rock. All right. Ooh, glory. Okay, watch this. Ooh. The word. Some of y'all gotta get on this thing. Jay, get on this side, sweet. Okay. He said, the word have I hidden in my heart. Now, in football, the I don't even watch. Glory to God. But the goal, Pastor Billy told me, is to get to the what's that called?
End zone.
Wait a minute. To get to the what?
End zone.
What happens when you get to the end zone?
Touchdown.
Glory be to God. That would mean victory. That would mean, we just did something here. Okay, now, think about that with life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do they need to take to the end zone?
The football.
The ball. Mm-hmm. All right, so for this lesson, the ball is the word.
Right.
Y'all ready?
Yes.
The ball is the word. What y'all gonna do with the ball? Who? Somebody hikes it, right?
Somebody
hikes the ball. Okay, so Holy Ghost gonna hike the word to you.
Mm-hmm.
Wait a minute. Holy Ghost gonna do what? Hike the word to you. What you gotta do when Holy Ghost gets ready to hike the ball?
Right.
Do you bend down in position after he throws it?
No.
When you get in position?
Before.
You already in position?
Yeah.
All right. Boom, you want to hike it?
Who am I hiking?
Let's hike it to them. They look like they're ready for a ball.
Originally, yeah, I'm going to just throw it like this.
Okay.
Originally, you bent over and they handed you.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Holy Ghost.
All
Holy Ghost just gave you the word. What now? We can teach you this. There's two things you can do when the word is hyped. You can either receive it or reject it. When the word comes forth, you can either receive it or reject it. What you do? You receive. Now watch this. We'll go there next week. Watch this. Once you receive the word, what you gotta do? Hey. Okay. Wait a minute, this gets even better. I said, this is a possibility. I said, ooh, this is good. Because this is not about one person. One person don't make a team.
Wow. Ooh. There's no I in team.
Watch this.
No I in team.
Watch this. That's why we removed the center aisle today.
That's right.
Why? Because we want to be a team.
Amen.
Right? So we can be a team. We need to pull together. I love this because it don't make sense for me to get down here. I said, boo, everybody on the team, even the ones on the bench, when they win the game, who wins? Everybody wins.
But sister, say this to him now. When we say you can either reject it or receive it, in football, you either can catch the ball or you can fumble it. So that means the word, you either can catch it or fumble it, which means the word doesn't came to you, it's fumble. It's on the ground.
Oh, wait a minute. Fumble.
Good. What about interception?
Don't fumble. We can't do that.
But the fumble.
Jump on it.
Don't fumble.
If you fumble.
If you fumble, didn't that mean you had it?
Yeah.
And Jay, you dropped it. Wait a minute. I had it, but I dropped it. What'd you say?
Something went wrong.
Something went wrong. I had it, but I dropped it. Uh-huh. Okay. So now, you got the ball. What you get ready to do?
I have to practice.
Somebody on their team?
Oh, no, on my team.
Wait a minute. Do you know how many times you receive the word and then you throw the ball to the other
the
team?
Enemy.
Wait a minute. Watch this.
Wow.
What you talking about? You threw the ball away to the other team.
Wow.
The word came to you. And you didn't keep it because now you started talking like the enemy.
Absolutely.
Team. You done changed up. You done changed the play.
Come on.
When you started talking about stuff out of his playbook instead of out of this playbook. Right. Which playbook are you using? Which playbook are you using? Come on, which playbook are you using?
And if you're not careful, right, it is so much to hold us and protect that word. Because anyone on the opposite team is trying to do one thing. Get the ball from me.
What y'all trying to do to them?
We're trying to take it.
Y'all trying to take the ball. I hate to tell y'all, but y'all on the other team. Y'all on the enemy's team. Y'all are part of the thing. Y'all trying to get the word from them. That's the assignment of the enemy. What he trying to do? Get the word from you?
Discourage.
And you know what the enemy, we already know what the enemy got. Three things you do. What do we do?
Kill, and destroy.
Anything else, you already know he's not playing.
Oh, I love this, because watch this. When they line up, they line up a line.
That's right.
Anybody understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So somebody getting in front of her. 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 Watch this. I love this. What? What does the enemy come to do? Steal, kill, destroy. What did Jesus just tell us to do? See it, say it, do it. Align.
That's right.
Everything that he got, God got something to.
That's right.
Oh, you trying to steal, kill, destroy. Well, you going to see it, say it, and do it. Right? You got it lined up. You ready? You ready? Right? If you fumble the ball, now what?
I mean, you can pick it. If a team player fumbles the ball, the team, we can pick it up.
Or they all spamming
trying,
trying
to get it.
Wait a minute. Everybody trying to get the ball.
Yeah.
From the team. Why y'all trying to recover the ball?
To protect.
Wait, y'all trying to protect the ball.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I love this right here. Okay, I need y'all to hear this. Please hear this. Please hear this. Please hear this. See, that's why you can't just come to church for you. Right, come on, hear this. That's why you can't just come to church for you. That's why you can't sit there, hear her testimony, just hear it, go home and forget all about what she just said. Let me tell you what's gotta happen. Somebody gotta care enough about the team to say, I'ma call her next week. I'ma make sure she's okay.
y'all do some church stuff.
But when you call, now listen, your attitude got to be right. Because you may make that one call, don't get an answer, don't mean you don't make it again. You know, you had to. I tried to get her, so now she don't want to be bothered. You see how the enemy do us? So you got to say, okay, yeah, I didn't get that one. But my point is to do what for the team? I'm going to talk to that individual if I got to call it every 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Why? You are trying to win.
Yeah.
So you got to be persistent.
She don't answer the phone, you show up.
Persistent.
Wait, let's watch this. Household of Faith is a team ministry. Let's say that. Household of Faith is a team ministry. We're not individuals.
That's right.
We are a team. Everybody's going to win. Everybody getting a Super Bowl ring.
Right.
We all gonna knock the devil out. We all gonna have a party. We all gonna pour champagne over our head. Do you understand me?
Yeah.
And we're not gonna let you lose.
I is an individual. I is not in team. Team is spelled T-E-A-M. I is not in.
Glory to God. Okay, so we're learning a lot from this. Yourself. So what? Go ahead. What you got to say?
Back to the interception or fumble.
Interception, fumble. We didn't like it because they all of the CD picking up. Interception, fumble. What's an interception? Me and Pastor Billy been preaching this.
The other team can't get the ball.
No.
The ball.
Like if Jay was to be running and Jay, I'm trying to throw the ball to Jay, and then he comes.
Right.
Yeah, he catches the ball.
And then he comes and he grabs it before Jay gets it.
Okay. So wait, interception. Go ahead. Tell them what you were saying about interception. You go ahead and tell them first.
I played football for 12 years, so. when the other team tries to get the ball, the objective of the game is for them to get the ball. If they get the ball via interception or a fumble, then they dictate the game.
Yep. Right.
Then
wait a minute. Whoever gets the ball dictates the game?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Did y'all hear that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, so let's talk about this in line with the word. Whoever gets the word dictates the game.
That's right.
No, yeah.
Wait a minute. That's why you got to hold that word. Now wait, wait, wait. How are you holding on to that ball when you start going down the field?
I mean, I only always see, well, I'm a Dallas Cowboys fan, so when my quarterback or whomever holds the ball, sometimes he drops it, but, you know, he tries to hold it like it, he tries to hold it like
it. Why are you holding it like that? Trying to protect it. Tell me y'all protecting the words that you receive.
That's my point.
How you do that? Let's talk about some stuff. How you do that? How you protect that word? Jesse said, hide it in your heart. Jesse, how you do that, darling? How you do that?
You keep going up.
You see it, say it, and do it?
See it.
So when you see it, say it, and do it, the more you do it, you're putting a tighter grip on the ball. Wait a minute. The more I rehearse the word, I put a tighter grip on the ball. Let's say that. The more I rehearse the word, I put a tighter grip on the ball. Because I ain't going to let them knock the ball out of me.
But see, the enemy try to catch you off guard. So some guys run with the ball and it's real loose. The first thing the guy designed to do is to punch the ball.
Wait.
Hard, trying to knock it.
So they try to come and get the ball away from you.
Or when he tackle you, he's punching it.
Wait,
to try to hit the ball out your hand.
Okay, so wait a minute. What's this tackling? Tackling? I love this right here. So they can come and tackle you.
Yes.
They can come and tackle you. That's what this evil spirit's trying to do.
That's
they come tackle you. Why are they trying to tackle you? They trying to get that word out of your heart. Now watch this. But watch this. The people on your team, what are they supposed to be doing for the person who has the ball?
Exactly.
They run ahead of the person with the ball so they can make a way for the person to run to get over there. Wait a minute. So somebody blocking for you.
Yes. Right. That's why they got those.
But point out. Point out to them tackling. Now listen. Point out to them tackling in this football game, he's coming to grab you to pull you down. The enemy tackles you in your thought process.
Ooh.
So when you're looking for a tackle with the enemy, he's talking to you in your thought process so it cannot penetrate.
Oh, he's trying to tackle in my thought?
So he's tackling you in your mind.
Oh,
when he tackles you in your mind, whether you're doing it, he done already tackled you if you're entertained. Football, they tackle you for. And the enemy attacks you at your thought process. When he can get your thought process, he got you. He done tackled you. So keep in mind when you're talking the word, he's trying to eliminate that word before going to what? Your heart.
He got something. What do you
want to
say,
Ronnie? What I'm saying, whether you're on offense,
whether you're on offense or defense, one thing, we can all can be on the same play, the same accord. Everything got to align on offense within the same means of the play. Same thing aligns up with God. When we line up in the Word, everybody in the household of faith need to be aligned in the Word.
Amen.
So the posing for the offense is to protect your people.
That's right.
Defense, our thing is as I'm using as the devil word, our game is to take from your people.
Absolutely.
So offense, you got to protect, you got to be lying in the same word, in the same place.
Okay, ooh, this good, right?
Amen.
Should we let them play, just do a play real quick?
Yeah.
No, Jeffrey said no,
what,
no.
What do you mean? Give me a little
not all the way.
Okay.
Not all the way, not all the way, not all the way. Okay, all right, what you got?
The defense lines up based off of what the offense lines up in. So whatever formation we come out in, then they adjust their strategy to try to man up.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. So the devil's team, they study the other team in advance.
Well,
they start watching their play last week.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. What,
in the pro, they go and watch tapes. They watch the game. They study their plays so that when they see that setup, they know what they do. So the enemy knows you didn't read your word tonight. I could come to you tomorrow because you didn't study the play. I'm studying you. He's checking you out all the time. Where's the weakest point? Where can I get in at? Oh, she weak on the right. She weak on the left. Let me just say this here. Entertain this.
Go ahead. What?
Okay, asking that question because that was good. What he just said. So you know how he said we're lining up on the same offensive thing? Isn't that why they started blocking the, not their hearing or not really using the playbooks, they started knowing the plays.
Oh yeah, you got to know the play. Because if you don't know the play, if I tell you you're going to run a 24-7 on 5, and the 24 minutes, you got to go to the 2-hole or the 4-hole, and you got to be on point. Because that guy blocking may only block him a matter of a second to get you through the hole. So if you ain't hitting through the hole and you don't know it, you don't know the play. Oh, you got
to
know the run.
Oh, so you can't go read the playbook in the middle of the play?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. You can't go read the playbook. You can't say timeout.
No.
Go read the playbook.
No.
Why do you?
Why
do you think a professional team only has so many people on it? Everybody cannot remember the plays in order to do this. So you got to know the playbook. It could be 1,000 plays in the book. You got to know 1,000. You say play number 2. If you don't know it, you can't play. So this word, you got to know the word so you know which defense you're going to use against the enemy.
Wait a minute. So you got to explain it. So he's studying you. Are you studying him?
See?
Right. Wait, come on. He's studying you. Are you studying him? Do you know how he operates?
See?
Come on. You got to... there's familiar spirits. They're familiar with you, but you need to operate in the familiar too. I know how that spirit tries to operate in my house. I know how that spirit tries to operate in my family. I know what you know. Oh, because I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to see it, say it, do it. I'm going to be ready.
Yes.
And speak to it. Say, hey, I identify who you are. You won't operate here. Stop and decease right now what you're trying to do. I take control of it. You won't do it here.
You can't do it here. Glory to God.
Go. Open the door, kick him out, and slam the door behind him. I said, go. You need to speak to that joker like you mean what you say.
All right.
You play with him, he's going to sit around with you, want to eat cereal, and have time for that.
I'll send somebody to the hallway. Because when I see people walk through, I know they sent by God, but Jermaine got it.
Mm-hmm.
She got it. Glory be to Jesus.
Praise God.
Go ahead.
So I saw a point I wanted to make is the devil, sometimes he can't get you all the way, but like with the team, it's different ways you can
make room for them.
You can, you can get a touchdown. If you can't get a touchdown, you can get a field goal.
Uh-huh.
So the devil, he don't always get you the way he wants, but any way he can get you, he'll get it. Just like when people... just like when we try to score, we may not can get the whole thing, which is a 7 points, and we can get that field goal, which is a 3 points. So
wait a minute. So suppose I want a touchdown. See, you gotta watch that. I can get a field goal, at least get some points.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because sometimes it comes down to the end. All you needed was that one, right, to win the game. So don't get discouraged if it's only 1 point, if it's only 2 points, if it's only 3 points. Come on. See, the problem is everybody want to do that little dance at the goal line, at the fifth, at the end zone. See, sometimes I'm waiting for a whole team to break out and dance. See, not just the person that made the play. See, that's what the world does. What the church got to do, when the person makes the play, the whole team ought to celebrate.
So you got to be so, you got to be so intentional aware of what's going on. When you're playing this game, all you want is the victory or the win. If I win by one, I won. So we don't have to win by 15 to 20, because see, we go to running so fast, we lose insight of what's going on around us. And what happens, I can get to that end zone a yard before and start my dance, and the guy said, no touchdown. Why? You dropped the ball before you got over. Why? You celebrate before you get the victory.
Come on. Okay. All right. So show me what y'all, now the ball is what? What is the ball?
Word.
The word of God. What you gonna do with the word?
I'm gonna pass it.
Protect it. Right? So you come to church, you hear this word, you already know the moment you leave out of here, the enemy is lined up to get that ball out of your hand. That's his assignment. Right? What? They just taught me that the word of God can change my life. That the word of God is my weapon. The word of God is what I use. It's my Uzi in the spirit.
That's
come
right.
on here.
Right.
Come on, OG. Come
That's
on
right.
here. Come on, you OG.
Yeah.
Right? Are you an OG for God? Yes, I am.
Hallelujah.
Yes, I am. I'm equipped.
I'm equipped.
Come on here. You gotta understand. You gotta be prepared. Mm-hmm. What are we trying to tell you? He said, how can a young man cleanse his way? Taking heed to the word. We don't want you to come in here and just hear a sermon.
J-T.
I want you to hear it, see it, say it, and do it. Go home, practice this thing.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, stuff starts changing in your life. You say, man, this word is changing some things for me. Okay, ready?
Go ahead.
What you got?
I just got something. That's why you need a team.
That's why you need a team.
If Nella was the one that was running the play the whole round, because he's studying and she's having a good game, and y'all trying to get to the end zone, that's when you have to change your play up, because the Iowa football coach was telling us
it's
right. going Nella. So that weakest link that you think is the weakest
that's
one don't run the ball and score.
Absolutely.
Wait a minute.
I got that.
I love that right here. Wait a minute. They know they gonna get a ball to
Absolutely.
Her.
Right.
They already know the ball coming to her.
They key in on that player, which means everybody focus on that player, overwhelm them. But listen, what Pastor Love told you about the word, listen, the enemy don't wait till you get out the door to penetrate. Enemy, when we give you the word, trying to take it from your house, distractions. You heard that. You sit here, but now you think about what you're going to cook for dinner. You sit here, but now you think about, well, when I leave and what I got to do before I go home. It's distractions. So he done already got the word from you because you're not distracted. You're not paying attention long enough for to even get into the spirit, man. So he's trying to attack you right here. You can hear a word, but as soon as you finish it, he bam, bam, he bombarding you. So now you done lost five of them.
That's why I said take heed to
take
the word.
Take heed.
Wait a minute, because we were talking about this. How many times y'all sat in the room and the word just going on? And you, I said, Pastor Billy, there's a difference between hearing and taking heed.
That's it.
Wait, there's a difference. Right, I'm in the room, and I learned something about myself. Y'all know I like to tell on myself. I learned something about myself. Half the time he talking, I ain't paying attention to what he said. No. Seriously, I learned that about myself. He brought it to my attention, and I realized, yo, watch this. I heard him, watch it. I heard the words he said, but I didn't pay attention to the words. So then all of a sudden, you know, Josh Dutu, then come back and say, Mom, what'd you say?
Yeah, okay.
Wait. He heard every word that went out of my mouth. It went out of my mouth. He was in the room, right? In the room. Heard the word, but he wasn't paying attention to
it.
There's a difference. And
said,
so you have to discipline yourself.
I said, sweetie,
yourself.
You didn't hear me, sweetie. I said, let me say it again. She said, well, I heard that, but no. I need you to make sure so we can roll. Let me say it again. And it's okay. But we really, when you don't know that about yourself, you tend to do it right here.
I did it so much, I didn't even know I was doing
it. You don't know me doing
it. Until he brought it to my attention. So now guess what? I catch myself. I said, wait, I wasn't paying attention.
Say that.
Great. I start telling on myself now. I wasn't really paying attention. Tell me that again. So now I know myself. I gotta focus.
Right. You gotta be. Like, train yourself.
I can't do something else and be listening to what he's saying because I ain't listening to what he's saying.
You train yourself.
And so I train myself. So you gotta do that when you're sitting here for the word.
See, in the military was important because if it's only me and you, and I got to know what I'm telling you to do so that we can live, I need to tell you. And you want to hear every word you're trying to live. You want to come home. If you don't pay attention, one shortcut, one skip word can cost you your life. So I need to hear what you say, and then I may repeat it back to you. So you saying, we're going to do this, 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 and this. And when we not, we got the instructions. If we don't not, well, I missed something. So I need to be focused on what you tell me to do, because you say walk close, because I don't need to walk five.
Yeah, Holy Spirit is the coach. Holy Spirit is the one that tells us what to do. Holy Spirit will tell you when to switch the plate.
Absolutely.
Holy Spirit will tell you, no, they already know that. They already know that plate. Switch that up. Yes. Holy Spirit will tell you, no, lean to the right, lean to the right. See, Holy Spirit is the coach. Holy Spirit is the one leading you. Absolutely. Holy Spirit will tell you, no, line up different this time. See, they already expected that. Don't do that. No, don't go that way. No, Holy Spirit is the coach.
It's the coach.
How many of y'all, don't raise your hand. Just in your heart. How many of y'all ignored the coach? Right? He gave instructions, but you ignored the coach.
But listen now, the coach team is made up of several coaches. You have a head coach, you got a line coach, you got a running back coach, you got a quarterback coach, so it's several coaches. The one coach is responsible, Holy Ghost. But now what part of your coaching that you don't listen when the main coach tells you something to where you can throw off the whole play?
Oh, how about this attitude right here? I already know that.
Oh, that's what,
yeah. Don't y'all like that one? I already know that. Okay. I don't need to hear it, because I already know. I already know the play. I was at practice.
Yeah.
I already know. That I already know. Oh. The devil already know that you think you already know.
And you know what Dad Hagin said, when you think you know something, you're defeating yourself because you don't know enough. If you knew enough, anytime you come in this type of atmosphere, if you heard us preach this last week, anytime you come in this atmosphere, you forget what you heard last week. You come in now with the mind to learn something new today because you already heard that. That's what the enemy wants you to say. Why? You're not paying attention. So you need to come in any situation not knowing anything.
Just come in clean.
Come in clean. So that you can do what now? Receive what he wants you to receive at this point. So if the coach tells you, the coach may tell the quarterback, run the play. If you tell him that, quarterback may say 24 pitch on 7. He may come to the line and say 45, 82, 26, 27. He doesn't change the play. If you ain't paying attention, you're doing the same thing he just told you to do. He's yelling that out so no people can hear, but what is he doing? He changed the play. So if you're not paying attention, he altered the play. 25, 46, 81, you know the play was changed. But if you ain't listening, you sitting here still thinking he's going to do 84 and kill somebody.
All right, let's go. What did your aunt do with the ball?
Because I want to ask, because you guys, I don't know about football, but I ain't had to guess that you were. So you know how we were passing the ball, like when the quarterback is getting ready to like throw it or whatever the case is? What if they don't, like the quarterback don't run? What if they accidentally just on like a sneak tip? What do they call when they just slightly sneaky, like
pitch it,
give the ball to somebody else that's not there?
You can not, then you can pitch it, a handoff, it's a lateral, it's several things you can do, depending.
Several
things, but if he, you, quarterback may hand it to the running back. If I throw it, it's a pitch. If I lateral it back, this is the names I'm saying. And you could throw it to the right field. It's certain things they do. You know, so they got strategies, but you got to stay within the rules.
We can overload that
of the game.
Okay, man. No, you're not getting word.
All right, this is the word. This is the word of God.
My quarterback is not here.
303.
Oh.
All right, what you gonna do with the word? What you gonna do with the word? What you gonna do with the word?
You gotta protect.
Oh, I don't care how big he is, he ain't more powerful than the word.
That's right, the word, that's right.
That's right.
All right. We don't want to use it. We don't want anybody to get hurt.
Y'all get this? Okay, let's do this. I need the mic. Let's find out. What you get out of this word today? Pass the mic. Go out in the audience,
baby. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, we're going to end the thing. Oh, Jay got one more thing.
Is there another mic?
Wait, Josh, we'll come do this.
In football, we used to study the players so much. What's her name? Jay. And her. We used to study football so much, but a wide receiver is the person who's going to go out and catch the ball.
Okay.
So if I'm the quarterback, and she's a wide receiver, I'm going to stand like this.
She knows it's Jess.
I don't know what she's doing. Stand.
So y'all see how I'm standing, right? And she's a defender. We used to study football players so much that the way she's standing, I know what her first step is going to be.
Wait a minute, that's good. Did y'all hear that? The way she's standing, he already knows what she's getting ready to do.
By the way she's standing, I know which way she's going to go, so I'm going to line up this way. Because this foot right here, that means she's coming at an angle. So I'm going to line up and I'm going to take the angle away, and I'm going to push her this way. So next time.
But how do you know that?
How do you know her line?
I understand.
How did you know that's
her? Because I studied what she's
doing.
I've studied.
All right.
So based off of the way she's standing, and if you switch your foot, she's standing like that.
She's going straight.
She's going straight, or she's going to try to come around me. So if she tried to take that first step, I'm going to push her back based off of her stance.
Wow. So how do we use that in the spirit realm? How do we use that? If the enemy can study the way I'm standing, come on.
Oh, if he's studying the way you're standing, then you got to know how to change. You got to know how to switch up.
Wait a minute. See, I can't do that. Ali used to do that right there. Ali, shuffle. Ali, shuffle. Right? You don't know what I'm about to do. You don't know what foot I'm giving you. You don't know what scripture I'm about to pull out. You don't know.
But if you got enough word in your enemy, don't know what you're going to do. The enemy will know
you.
If you got enough word in your enemy.
If you only got one, he already know what you're about to pull out. But if you got what we say, a household of faith, we pack it.
The enemy only know what you got.
We got bullets up in here.
You
know more than one verse, don't you? You know more than one, don't you? Yeah. Glory be to God.
Throw all five of them at him. Listen, if you got one, he cannot deal with you.
What time is it?
That's the truth. If you got one scripture and you stand on the one scripture, it is enough to defeat any enemy, any trials you're going through, any sickness, anything you're dealing with. One scripture. If you just know, listen, the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not
live. That's all I know.
That's enough.
Who goes? Somebody said, so the woman who was caught in adultery, and Jesus said to her, I don't condemn you, go and sin no more. So what did we learn? What did he give her so she could sin no more? He gave her that word. So what's she going to do to that word? She going to protect that word like we did that ball. And every time adultery tried to talk to her, here come this fine Negro, excuse me, and he tried to talk to her. And all of a sudden, and she's like, go and sin no more. Wait a minute. She rehearses the word.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, what do we do? See it, say it, do it. What do we do?
See it, say it,
do it. What's the it? See the word, say the word, do the word. Do it again.
See the word, say the word, and do the word.
I rehearse that word.
Right, and she should have it so much if he say hello, she say, I should go and sin no more. Not hello to him. It should be rolling her head when he say hello, she say, I should go and sin no more. He said, I said hello, I should go and sin no more. That should be the first thing coming to mind.
Hey, and guess what? See, and you don't act stupid. Like, you don't be at work. Go and sin no more. Yeah. See, you're supposed to be typing. Right? See, you can't be like that.
Yeah.
See, that's how religion presents itself, right? And that's why people don't want to be saved.
Yeah. Man,
that's why they don't want to come to church. That's why they don't want that stuff. Because that religion stuff. So you can't do that. But you can do that in your mind. You don't even have to say it out loud.
The man asks you for the report and you come out going to sin no more.
In the name of Jesus. Why don't you say hope? You go in the bathroom.
That's
you shut
right.
up to
that's
you.
Right.
But it's so
that's right.
I'm going to bind all the spirits up in here.
Something going on in here.
And then I go back out to my bed and I cut like I got Christian.
And you can't.
You take authority over come on here. You take authority over stuff.
Yes.
Right? You use your weapon and shut that foolishness down.
Thank you, Jesus.
But you know that crazy.
No.
Come on here.
Folks looking at you finna call someone with a straight jacket because you want, go and send them money. They ask you, where's the report there? This is $1 million project. Where is the report? You're about going to sin no more. He's looking at you, about to call. He's going to lose $1 million. Listen to me. Do your job as unto the Lord. When you're at work, work. Don't take the pens. Don't take the pencils. They're not yours. So what happens, seriously, and then you can go in the bathroom and pray all that, but you need to make sure everything you're doing is unto the Lord. What they don't see, God see it all. Excellent. Seriously.
Excellent.
Don't be, you know, come on. Man, need a report. You come up, go and sit no more. He's going to send you to the straitjacket place, and he's going to tell him, do not send him back here.
And then,
it's nonsense.
And then you're going to call your pastor and say,
yeah,
pastor,
I got fired.
I need a job. Would you pray for me? Right? Foolishness. Right? We got to be wise.
Wise.
Right? Okay. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for what you've said to us. I thank you, Father. Matter of fact, let's do this too. Well, thank you, Father, for the word of God that's going forth, even out on Facebook Live.
Yes.
Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you, Father, that everybody who's watching, that they also saw the plays and that they can see themselves holding the ball, protecting the ball, carrying the ball, running into the end zone. See, you got to think that. You got to see that in your mind.
Yes.
Before you even play the game, you already see yourself on the field.
Yes.
You already see yourself making a touchdown.
Yes.
No matter what the enemy is showing you, you got your own picture of this game. I see us as the victors. Glory to God. And so right now, we speak to you and we pray for you that you understand how valuable the word is, how precious the word is. You don't allow nobody to take your ball from you. So Father, we thank you now. And if you don't know Jesus, you can't run a play without the coach. You need to know Jesus. Ask him, come into my heart. I don't understand all this stuff they talking about, but I know I'm tired of losing these games. I know I'm tired of getting beat up. I know I'm tired of living my life this way.
Yes.
And they said the ball works and the ball is the word.
Yes.
God, come into my life. I receive you now. Yeah, change me. Yeah. Find you a good church. A church that's teaching the word. If you don't understand the preacher, go to the next place.
Yes.
Yes. Be blessed today.
And anybody sitting under that same thing in this room, you qualify.
Yes.
Listen to me. You must make sure Jesus is Lord in your life, because you can't, listen, if you're trying to be victorious, you can't win. You can't even start to play this game if he's not Lord of your life.
Yes.
So if you're going to play and win, you must have him as Lord of your life, so that he can share the faith with you. So Holy Spirit will speak to you. Holy Spirit, listen, a lot of things we do is not